I'm David Crow. Thank you for tuning in to episode 223 of my weekly radio show, The Infectious Myth. Email me at david.crow@theinfectiousmyth.com. That's Crow with an E. Join the discussion and like us at facebook.com/theinfectiousmyth. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at infectiousmyth. Listen Tuesdays at 2 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time on prn.fm or subscribe to the podcast on iTunes or other programs. You can listen to any of the last five episodes over the phone by dialing the U.S. number 701-719-0990. You can also call voicemail 862-800-6805. Make sure you indicate that the questions for the show and leave your name. If you dial either of these numbers, long-distance charges may apply. I don't know that you're a listener until I hear from you, so send me a message. Let me know how you stay in touch with the show and what you like about it. If you include your mailing address, I'll send you a little thank you gift, one of the bookmarks I make by hand using my own photographs. We seem to be having a habit now of hearing from listeners who aren't excited about one of my guests or one of my topics, and they have a different opinion. That's great, and today we have another such guest. After I published episode 219 with Tim Noakes, who advocates a keto diet, I was contacted by an old friend, Keidi Awadu, who had some issues with the claims of Tim Noakes about a high-fat diet heavy with meat and other animal products. So this is what he said. I'm a regular listener to The Infectious Myth and regarded as one of the best health shows to be found. I'm listening right now to Tim Noakes bashing the vegan lifestyle with terribly inaccurate statements. It's a religion and it's a cult. Balderdash. I've been vegan, advancing to 97% raw superfood diet for nearly 40 years, and I know he doesn't know the truth about vegan and disease resistance. When he's talking about South Africans on a, quote, high carbohydrate diet, he's avoiding pointing out that these people are suffering severe malnutrition due to the raging poverty in South Africa. That same population is subject to pellagra, which mimics the symptoms of AIDS, due to the high amount of maize in the diet and the lack of vitamin B6. So Keidi joins me today. He's a raw vegan chef, currently living in Las Vegas. He's written numerous books. Some of the titles are Living Superfood Recipes, Living Superfood Research, and How Do You Stay So Fit? He also has a radio show, The Conscious Rasta Report. Welcome to the show, Keidi.
My friend, David Crow, it's been too long since you and I have had formal on-air conversations. I'm a regular listener. I like what you do. And it's a pleasure to be with you today, my friend.
Yes. And when I was thinking, this is probably the second time recently that somebody's contacted me to say they really disagreed with an episode. And first of all, I really like to have my guests give their opinions. So that might mean that there's other potential guests who have different or even opposite opinions. And, you know, there's lots of issues that I discuss, like nutrition, where I have some knowledge, but nowhere near the depth that is needed to really be an advocate for one position or another. So I'm really pleased that you can join me for this. But we should talk about how we first met, because we had a mutual friend, Christine Maggiore, who is an outspoken HIV-positive woman who rejected a lot of the so-called HIV-AIDS science. It wasn't really science in many ways, especially the need for drugs. And I think she lived about 15 or more years after her diagnosis, mostly in good health until the very end. And her death about 10 years ago is still disputed, with different sides taking different, seeing her death in completely different ways. So, Keidi, maybe you can talk about your relationship with her.
Like yourself, I had the utmost of respect and admiration for this beautiful, wise spirit amongst us, Christine Maggiore. I got a chance to know her really quite well, as we were both members of the Southern California-based community that was investigating this, the HEAL organization. Mm-hmm. And over the course of several years, we became closer and closer, to the point that because I was writing on the topics of what I called in my writings the Great AIDS Hoax, We were traveling around the country doing conferences together, campaigns together. I'll never forget the time we all showed up in New York City at the UN Plaza for a rally we called Hands Off Thabo Mbeki, the then president of the Republic of South Africa, who had come out rather openly questioning whether what the world was being told about HIV/AIDS in South Africa was actually verified by available facts. And so Thabo Mbeki was a very brave man, and Christine and I and many others, Dr. Michael Elner, who himself has passed on into the realm of the ancestors, were there. We had a wonderful time. So when it comes to Christine, I carry her memory very fondly. She was vilified and attacked by corporations, especially those who were profiting off of this HIV pharmaceutical industries, et cetera. And I know her life, I know her family, and I knew the circumstances around her death. And the truth be told, Christine was suffering from a very high degree of mental and environmental stress. And ultimately, it was the stress that took her past the limit to where her body could recover from the very challenges that she was having, whether those challenges would be attributed to HIV or to the common stresses that Americans go through. And after their interfacing with the medical industry, according to my research, as many as 1,154,000 Americans died in 2018 because of iatrogenics, death by doctor.
Yeah,
Christine, I feel, was one of those as well.
Yes, I mean, for Christine, the first really tragic event was the death of her daughter, EJ, which I think was around 2005. And, analysis of her death was that EJ died from an antibiotic reaction. She'd never had antibiotics before in her young life, and she took them once for a severe ear infection, and within, I think, 24 or 48 hours, she was dead. And I know Christine told me that after that, she was unable to eat or sleep properly. She just didn't have an appetite, and it was difficult for her to sleep. People used to talk about a broken heart, and although people mock those terms as you know, unscientific, I really think, whatever you call it, that the stress of a major personal tragedy can set you on the road to your own decline. And particularly when people are out there saying that you're a murderer, you murdered your own child, you're responsible for the murder of millions of people around the world. I mean, she got vitriol like almost nobody else.
Mm-hmm. You make some excellent points. As you are well aware, much of my own life, career, my writings, my research is founded upon the sciences of cellular biology. And so when we talk about how our mental status affects our body, we can use the excellent research of Dr. Bruce Lipton in his book Biology Beyond Belief and our understanding of epigenetics, how these mental psychological processes actually do cause chemical changes in the blood that eventually shows up in cellular reaction. My study on my broadcast today focused on the very topic of gut microbiome and epigenetics expression, meaning how the use of, or how the Western diet, and in particular, how the use of pharmaceutical drugs, what are called the xenobiotics, impact negatively on this complex bacteria in our gut called the microbiome, which then immediately signals through epithelial cellular interfaces, the lining between our gut and our blood system, changes can show up in the very nucleus, in the very DNA and genetic expression in a very short period of time. I know it's complex, but there's always an explanation to show how the mind and the environment connect to the very essential life processes.
Yes. Well, to go back to AIDS for a moment, I'm sure you talked a lot about AZT, which was the first AIDS drug ever approved. And that directly attacked DNA synthesis. So, so some drugs may have cellular destruction as a side effect, but in the case of AZT, that was the intended effect. It was intended to block DNA synthesis, and you know, that has obviously an impact on the cell nucleus directly, but also on the mitochondria, which are necessary for energy, energy management in the body, and of course also on the gut bacteria. It attacks their DNA as well. So that's just an extreme example of where a pharmaceutical drug can attack so many different systems in the body. And I don't think people pay enough attention to the gut and the influence of the gut on the brain and on everything. I mean, if your gut's not healthy, you're not absorbing food. And, you know, that's a recipe for decline and death. Anyway.
And you know, that brings us right back around to the very subject of which you and I are talking today, about which pathway forward best supports this spectrum of bacteria, some 100 trillion of which occupy the human gut. The overwhelming majority of them are called friendly bacteria for good reason. Is that which nutritional lifestyle pattern moves us forward best? Is it the standard Western diet, which we know is overly heavy in overall calories, in highly processed foods, refined carbohydrates, excessive amounts of meat and dairy and eggs and sugar that have never been consumed at this level in human history, or the tradition of plant-based diet, of which vegetarian and vegan are higher expressions thereof? I myself, as you've mentioned before, I'm a raw foodist, and I've been a raw vegan chef and practitioner now for some 9 years. And so we've got a lot to look at today. People do want to do the best they can, and by listening to you, David, and listening to myself today, I hope we're going to help the people get into a better position.
One of the problems, I think, with one of the strengths and weaknesses of science is that it tends to take one variable at a time. And the weakness is sometimes it focuses on a variable and it kind of ignores all the others. Like there was for a time a really big focus on salt, and it became like the only thing that was important in the diet. So we had to go on a low salt diet. Different kinds of fats have been approached at different times. Sugar rarely got enough attention. But that, I think, is a huge component of the Western diet that both people like Tim Noakes and yourself can agree is like a drug or a poison in a way. That if you consume enough sugar, you will end up diabetic and you'll end up with heart disease and all kinds of other problems. One thing in there's a book, Big Fat Surprise, which promotes a similar diet to Tim Noakes. And one of the things that she pointed out is that there are peoples, cultures, both at both extremes. There are, in places like India, people that are traditionally vegetarian, and then there are people like the Inuit, people who were previously called Eskimos, who had a diet that had almost no vegetables in it, that was almost completely animal products. And yet both those people, you know, were reasonably healthy and reproduced. And, what do you say about the variety of traditional diets around the world?
We have some pretty good research from which to make deductions and conclusions. We have to recognize first and foremost that all of us are individuals. There's a thing called differential diagnosis. There's a new terminology in the field of medicine, traditional allopathic medicine, called precision medicine, where they are now customizing medicine for the individual. And of course, as we know, they are still very much interested in the profitability of precision medicine. Right. Some of these procedures are extremely expensive and thus prohibitive. But what is not being talked about is precision nutrition. Now, this is where I work specifically as a clinical nutritionist, is that you are a distinct individual. If you are suffering from some sort of diagnosis, the pathway to your diagnosis, which we call pathogenesis, was distinct for your case. It could be environmental exposures, mental exposures, could be what you had to eat so far in the last 24 hours or lifetime patterns. It could be things such as our biological background, such as South Asians and many of the Bantu phenotype, which is Central and East Africa, are nearly completely lactose intolerant after the age of 36 months of age, whereas Northern European people, many of them produce a lactase enzyme well into their adult life, so they are able to digest milk and dairy products. So things have to be distinctly formulated for our own individual pathways moving forward. Yet, the human biological type, the phenotype, most closely resembles that of higher primates. Now, when we look at animal species defined, answer these questions, do vegetarians and vegans live longer than their carnivore or omnivore comparison species? Because you don't want to compare a large land mammal with a small bird. But when we compare these species across the different type of cross connection, such as the largest land mammals, the African elephant lives some 60 to 70 years life expectancy, mm-hmm. while the largest land carnivore species, the polar bear, lives 20 years on average life expectancy, thus giving the African elephant, a strict vegan, we might say, a 325% life expectancy advantage. We can see this consistent across various animal species, large reptiles, the Galapagos tortoise versus the African crocodile, give the tortoise a 202% advantage.
Nobody can live longer than the tortoises.
The 172-year average life expectancy for that Galapagos tortoise.
Right, but
the
don't
crocodiles
also live pretty long lives, alligators and crocodiles?
The crocodile can live 70 to 100 years for the specific African crocodile, which is quite a wonderful life expectancy unless you compare it to other reptiles, which, according to the Galapagos tortoise, has as much as a 202% advantage. We see the same thing comparing strictly vegan or vegetarian birds, the gray parrot versus the vulture, both African continental species, give the parrot a 533% life expectancy mm-hmm. advantage. And then the last species I compare in my book, Living Superfood Longevity, comparing savanna mammals, they're living in the same environment. If we compare the giraffe living on average to be 28 years of age versus the lion living to be 14 years of age, the giraffe has a 200%+ advantage.
Yes. If we can go back to intolerances for a minute, two that are very common these days are lactose and gluten. And the assumption with lactose intolerant is that it's racial, but I'm wondering has anybody looked at whether it's actually kind of epigenetic, that if you, for example, grow up, you know, drinking milk and other milk and various milk products, that you will be more tolerant of milk later in life, as opposed to people who live in a culture that, say, like a Asian culture that tends not to include milk products in their diet?
Well, that's a very interesting question. Can we build up a resistance to that which essentially functions as a toxicity, as a poison? Yes, we can build up resistance to poison or acceptance of the consequences. Many people don't really realize the way that their body reacts to these allergy-forming substances that they're consuming until they go on a detoxification fast. Many of my nutrition clients, they want to transform their body rather rapidly, get rid of a diagnosis such as hypertension or diabetes or want to reduce their weight consistently and have that weight stay off. Well, one of the things that I can do with them, I say, I want you to take a 30-day detox fast from certain of the foods which we know are particularly aggravating. What we find, David, is that many times after taking an extended break from eating these foods, the first time that they go back to eating the food, the body has a rather significant allergic reaction, an inflammation reaction, producing a lot of mucus that's rather noticeable. And so in the long run, the complexity of the design of the human biology is incredible. I mean, it's taken, if you include the species from which we evolved, we're talking over 3 million years of biological distinction have now formed this high species we know as Homo sapiens with all of their complexity, which also includes such a complex brain psychological thought process that, David, many of us actually eat ourselves to harm and injury, a process that I have termed chewicide.
Chewicide. Yes. Well, I think there's, unless you're working for a multinational food corporation, you probably realize that the Western diet has some pretty big problems. Going to gluten intolerance, theories that I've heard about gluten intolerance, and I admittedly haven't done much research in this area, are that they're caused by vaccines causing, you know, the immune system to reject gluten, caused by the breeding, the sort of the inbreeding of wheat species versus the older species of wheat. And the third is that just the high level of processing of the wheat and other grasses. You know, what's your opinion about I mean, do you agree that there's a big increase in gluten intolerance, or are we just recognizing it more?
It's hard to tell. On the surface, I would say, yes, we are witnessing a rise in gluten intolerance, but we're also witnessing even more dramatic rises in other expressions of immune health, such as look at cancer. In the year 1900 in the United States, it was expected that one out of every 24 people would have a diagnosis of cancer at death. One century later, in the year 2000, it was one out of every 4 people. And now, 19 years into the new century, it has exceeded one of every 3 Americans will be diagnosed with cancer. And according to one recent British study, it's predicted that in this lifetime, our children will see one of every 2 people diagnosed with cancer. So we can definitely tie cancer to inflammation, to immune system malfunctions, et cetera. And this, the rates of this are just explosive. So it's really hard to put your finger on any one thing. I think a lot of the focus on gluten is also ignoring another modern protein, apparently a fairly recent creation, in the dwarf wheat variety, which has become popular over the last 4 decades or so, producing nearly all of the wheat consumed. And, of course, wheat is also a product that's subject to genetic modification to tolerate high levels of wheat killers. But this new protein, everyone's talking about gluten, and they should be talking about gluten. If it's problematic, they need to be talking about it. But no one's talking about gliadin, G-L-I-A-D-I-N, this protein, and how it functions as an opiate. It binds to opiate receptors in our brain, and for many people, this also is hyper-stimulating their appetite. So there are problems with the wheat that people are consuming, especially because it's refined, highly processed. Many of the key nutritional components of natural wheat and grains are being removed by this processing, processing that's going on. What is natural and digestible eventually becomes a poison to more and more people. It's a complex set of affairs. I'm glad that people are thinking about it, but I tell you, sometimes the anti-gluten hysteria and hype can be a bit obnoxious, David.
Yes. How much do you think, like, one of the things with processing of things like flour is really just the size of the particles. Like from eating, for example, soaked wheat kernels, which can be edible if they're soaked and cooked, versus cracked wheat versus a coarse flour versus, you know, what you get in say an industrial bread, which is extremely small particles. So your absorption obviously is going to be much faster. So that white flour that's very finely ground is going to act in your body more like sugar than something coarser. Like, how much of an impact do you think that has?
That's an excellent question, an excellent point you make. And we can correlate to that the more rapidly this food leaves the plate, leaves the fork, and goes into the bloodstream, the less likely it is that key components of the digestive system will have a chance to fully integrate with these exogenous proteins that are coming into the body. So we do know, I mean, if you were to take these exogenous proteins, meaning from outside the body, and inject them directly into the blood vessel through a hypodermic needle, you probably would cause an extreme autoimmune reaction, and the person might go into anaphylactic shock and maybe die on the spot. But when we rush these foods through our mouth, as opposed to getting the refined grains in pastry, which they're highly refined, highly miniaturized or microlized, as you'd say, that's quite distinct than having to chew. Our teeth were designed to chew these grains, but we chew. The more we chew, the more our saliva is engaged in the process. The saliva contains a very important digestive enzyme called amylase, which breaks down complex carbohydrates into more simple carbohydrates, which are easily digested and absorbed within the system. We're also putting an extreme amount of stress on the pancreas when we consume these foods without using the amylase in our saliva to properly prepare them for absorption. So you're making a very good point. The faster that food races into our bloodstream that's not designed to do that, the more problematic it's going to be. Well, on the other hand, things like chlorophyll, which is the green found in plant materials, well, that type of liquid chlorophyll containing high amounts of magnesium and other critical nutrients, that getting into the bloodstream as fast as possible actually produces an incredibly beneficial outcome, raising the oxygen-carrying capacity of our blood almost immediately.
One of the things that you claimed when you wrote to me was that vegans and vegetarians have lower rates of being overweight and obesity, and that's linked to a vast spectrum of chronic and acute disorders. We've talked about diabetes and cardiovascular disease. But that's actually the same claim that's made by people who advocate something like the keto diet. I don't think any reasonable person would make that claim about the standard Western diet. So what's the evidence that, what's the evidence of lower obesity in vegans and vegetarians? And is it all types or just some types of diets?
We, in the book Living Superfoods Longevity, I compared dietary patterns. There was a switch of South African study that was rather noted. There was a switch between African Americans and South African of the black phenotype. And they switched their diet for, I think, 2 weeks or a month or so. And they found that the African Americans, upon eating the South African diet, which was much higher in unprocessed foods, much higher in fiber and other distinctions, the South African stress marker or the African American stress markers went down rather dramatically. They were losing weight and having other positive benefits, whereas the South Africans, their stress markers immediately started going up, and they were gaining weight, and many of them started complaining that they felt, tired, no energy, while on this westernized diet. So we can see that comparison there as well. But if we look at the fundamentals of how the body interfaces with the food, one of the main criticisms that I have had with the paleo, the keto, the high fat, low carb, and the Atkins diet
right.
is that the amount of fiber in every one of those diets goes down dramatically the deeper one goes into them. There is no fiber in meat unless you're eating what natural meat eaters eat, and they will open up the belly of their prey and eat their intestines with the pre-digested fiber intact in the intestines. And if you try and feed that to most Americans, they're probably going to rebel to some extent.
I think so. I mean, that is definitely a criticism of a Western high-meat diet, is that the Western diet is almost exclusively focused on muscle meat. I remember as a child, my mother at times fed heart, liver, kidneys were quite common, quite a few different types of meat, as opposed to now it's like steak and ground beef, which is all muscle meat. Go ahead, sir.
Well, there is a distinction. And for people who do advocate eating meat, we do find that they say that the offal, or what are called visceral organ meats, the liver, the heart, the kidneys, and these other types, are actually better for you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we're looking, why would they be better for you? I can only speculate. Now, I don't necessarily agree with that, but we're talking about, we do listen to people who have other perspectives on nutrition. But I think that the reason they say so is that there are glandular secretions in these offal, or these visceral organs, glandular secretions that function the same way in those animals' bodies as they do in humans, that could be beneficial. If you're eating liver, then your certain enzymes and things that are part of that liver, if they survive the cooking process, which enzymes generally do not survive heating over 140 degrees,
right.
then they could be beneficial. But there are other glandular secretions that could be helpful. And the other part about it is at the end of that animal's life, during the slaughtering process, the animal's last reaction in life is to resist being killed,
right.
which means there's going to be an incredible dump of adrenaline and adrenal glandular secretions, fight or flight chemicals, are going to be dumped into the bloodstream of that animal, and they're immediately going to be rushed into the muscle tissue in order to stimulate those muscles to run, fight, get out of the situation that you're about to die in.
Right. I found on the website of a critic of vegan diets, a list of nutrients that are hard to get in vegan diets, according to this person. They included vitamin B12, choline, glycine, retinol, vitamin K2, DHA, iron, and zinc. So how do you deal with things that if you're not thinking about your diet, you're might not going to be getting?
That's a very good question, a serious question that vegans and vegetarians need to educate themselves up to. So in answering this question, if I don't eat the beef, where am I going to get my vitamin B12? I went out into the pasture, and I asked the steer. And the steer looked at me and said, moo. And I took
yes.
I took that to mean the steer says, I eat what nature designed for me to eat. I eat the grasses. I eat the grains. I eat the seeds. Now, on one hand, there are two key components to this understanding. Number one is when we're talking about, people will say, they'll often ask the question, well, if you don't eat meat, where are you going to get your protein? David, that's not even the right question.
Mm-hmm.
The right question is, if you're not eating meat, where are you going to get your essential amino acids? Of the 20 or so amino acids that there are, about 9 of them are called essential, meaning they have to be gotten from outside sources because the body doesn't manufacture them, doesn't synthesize them. And so the meat eaters almost never consume meat-eating animals. Can you think of any meat-eating animal that people consume? You really can't think of that. So they're all consuming vegetarian-based animals whose body has manufactured these essential amino acids, or they have acquired them from outside. And we do know now that seeds, hemp seeds, flax seeds, sunflower seeds, chia seeds, a spectrum of them contain all of the essential amino acids. Nuts and seeds contain all of the nutrition necessary for a plant to grow out of that. We know also a spectrum of sea vegetables contain all of the essential amino acids. And so it is not necessary to consume vegetarian species to get something that their bodies probably didn't manufacture either. And the other part about it is, if their bodies did manufacture it, and yes, they do, it's manufactured in the gut microbiome, the bacteria living in the gut of these animals, feeding off of plant-based materials. In their metabolism, they extract metabolites that include these essential amino acids, which kind of brings us back to a central part of the conversation we had earlier. The key to great health is a healthy colon. And if you compare the gut microbiome between animal-eating species, in this case humans, and plant-based humans, it is no denying, every research will confirm, that the vegetarians and vegans have a healthier natural gut microbiome than those who are consuming meat for various reasons. One of the reasons being that the animals used for meat are fed an unusual amount of antibiotics, which are completely hostile to the gut microbiome environment.
What about things like iron and zinc? Like I have to admit that cows have a lot of blood in them, and so they must get their iron from somewhere. You know, where do vegans get trace metals? Like, I guess iron's not really a trace metal. It's needed in quite large quantities. But iron and zinc and other trace metals, where do those come from?
The ideal place to get these would be from freshly picked organic plant-based materials, especially those which are fed in ideal soil. See, we have this farming system in this country and many Western countries based upon nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus, NPK fertilizer.
Mm.
But that doesn't contain that broad spectrum of micronutrients, microminerals that you're talking about that are critically necessary for us to sustain homeostasis, the completion of our health. I myself, David, and I'd love to show you the pictures. Right outside my kitchen door, I have one of the most beautiful organic gardening laboratories that one could ever imagine. And every organic gardener is so proud of their compost.
Mm-hmm.
And so in making the compost, all of the vegetable scraps that come through my kitchen make it into the compost where they're turned into a rich black loam, a soil that will grow anything by the microbiome in the soil. The bacteria that live in the compost heap turn the kitchen scraps into this rich black earth. Now, when I plant different species in that rich black earth, I might plant 28 different species in relatively the same space in the same soil, but the species all bring forward distinctive colors, distinctive flowering patterns, very distinct about all these different species. We do know now that the colors that we find in the vegetables are a way of telling us that the vegetable is fixing minerals a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking at beets and red and spinach and other things where we can see this deep red in the color spectrum, and we know that there's going to be iron present there. And so when we are eating the way that nature designed us to eat, that is in soil that contains the entire spectrum of the critical micronutrients, microminerals, as well as the critical spectrum of bacteria needed to convert those nutrients into another generation of digestibility.
One of the claims of people like Tim Noakes is that we need a lot more fat than carbohydrates in our diet. I think opinions differ with vegan and vegetarian diets. I mean, what is your approach to fats and oils?
the best balanced diet for a vegan or vegetarian, for a human being, is about 30% of our food to be coming from fats. Now we have to ask the question, what type of fats?
Mm-hmm.
I like to talk about clean fats or clean proteins. Now, people are always talking about, well, you got to eat your meat to get your protein, milk and dairy, etc. But when I talk about clean protein sources, I'm talking about things like seed oils, flaxseed oil, hemp seeds, organic sprouted tofu, which is, of course, from non-GMO, and sprouted, either sprouted or tofu, meaning it's fermented. We talk about tempeh. Fenugreek seeds are awesome. Lentils, green peas, chickpeas, cooked beans, many types of raw nuts, sea vegetables, black and wild rice. These are all clean protein sources. And so I contend that if you're getting 30% of your diet from fat, these clean protein sources are going to have the fat you need. And ultimately, it becomes a matter of performance. And I'm proud to say, Brother David, I'm proud to say that at age 63, I am living example of what an optimized lifelong commitment to a vegan lifestyle and a raw food, superfood lifestyle now is. I've never been on pharmaceutical drugs. I used to wear reading glasses. I no longer do. I have all my teeth intact. And this morning, I only did 150 push-ups in my morning single set. Yesterday, I did 165. I should have done better than that today, just so I could brag on your radio show.
Okay, yeah, you should have gone for 175. I don't know, what's the rate of fats in the standard Western diet? I mean, to some extent, there's a lot of deep-fried foods, but those are also usually deep-fried foods are extremely high in highly processed carbohydrates, you know, the batter that they deep-fry in, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, do you know in the standard Western diet, like, is 30% fat high, or is it the quality of the fat that's important?
Oh, you got it. Right on point. The quality of the fat. On one, the fat level is too high. But what makes it worse is that the fat that they're getting is, to a large extent, low-density lipoprotein, the so-called bad cholesterol, as opposed to the good cholesterol, high-density lipoprotein. And so this is the direct connection between people who consume high levels of animal-based fats and other highly processed oils and these other things, is that this LDL ushers the cholesterol, which our body needs. The whole anti-cholesterol campaign of the last 50 years, we now know, was mostly hype financed by corrupted studies that were financed by the sugar lobby industry, so they wouldn't be blaming heart disease on sugar, which they should have been held holding them responsible all along. So when we're consuming high levels of animal-based fats in the milk and dairy and eggs and meat and bacon and all that other stuff, and lard and butter, it ushers in the LDL. I should say the LDL ushers in the cholesterol, which gets up stored inside of fat cells in the body, and unfortunately is one, if not the primary cause of clogged arteries, which we know as atherosclerosis itself, one of the most dangerous indicators of a shortened life expectancy. But by consuming plant-based fats, through the seed oils and from plant-based foods, we're now consuming the high-density lipoprotein, which cleans up the mess that the LDL has created. This is why many of us, in dealing with clients who have our circulatory issues, clogged arteries, et cetera, we just say, well, we're going to put you on a maximum of HDL for a period of a few weeks and watch how the change happens. And the change can happen so fast. I've had clients who were suffered from stroke, who recovered quickly and completely within a week to 3 weeks by mainly focusing on consuming as much high-density lipoprotein.
And what oils do you use for that?
The best oil that I can recommend is hemp seed oil. That's number one. Flaxseed oil is definitely number two. But then, you know, there's a bunch of different oils that are available. Walnuts are an excellent source of omega-3 fatty acids. Many people use fatty fish as a source to get omega-3 fatty acids or essential fatty acids. I caution people against that. I can't say don't do it, but I caution against it because the fish supply system is, one, it's unsustainable, and two, it is thoroughly corrupted by the modern-day whole kind of wholesale processing of seafood nowadays. It's really gone bad.
Well, I guess there's a lot to be said about the entire sort of industrial food chain, because with our urbanized society, we're so divorced from the land. I think that when everybody was living on the land, people didn't need to think that much about their diet. It was sort of just part of the culture. But when you move into a city, it's the easiest thing to get is the cheap carbohydrates. You just need to go to a corner store and look at the horrifying foods that are you know, dominating the shelves. The things like the potato chips and the chocolate bars and all of those things that I think people on both sides of the nutrition debate, whether they're keto or vegan, would be equally horrified to see.
But yeah, and you make an excellent point. You know, when people critique or criticize the vegetarian and vegan lifestyle, I try not to get defensive. I just try to listen real close and say, okay, critique it, but be precise. Don't make generalizations that are not true or that you can't back up with database evidence. And when people say, well, I know a vegetarian, a vegan, and they're not healthy, I say, I agree with you. I have known vegans and vegetarians, good friends of mine, who died prematurely from chronic diseases. In the earlier days of the vegetarian-vegan lifestyle, we consumed a lot of highly processed foods made from soy. And there was no distinction. Is the soy GMO modified to tolerate high levels of glyphosate in the weed killer? And now we know glyphosate not only disrupts the gut microbiome, where the soy proteins are best digested in the lower gut, but it's also now the World Health Organization has pointed out that glyphosate is a likely carcinogen, cancer-causing agent, which is absolute destruction of the immune system as well. So I say to my vegetarian and vegan friends, if you're eating highly processed foods, you're a compromised vegan, a compromised vegetarian, and you cannot protect your health in this day of such an extreme spectrum of environmental challenges as you can by eating a more holistic, natural-based, whole plant-based dietary lifestyle. You know, David, my most recent book out, I have a series of books on living superfood, was called Living Super in Paradise, Creating Space for Perfect Health. And on page 11 and 12 of the book, I point to these two lists, one of mental stressors and a second list of environmental stressors. I think totaling about maybe 50 to 37 or so, more than 37 of the two lists. And unless and until we can create an environment in our world where we're not subjected to these stressors, we're not going to be able to fully live our lives. We're going to be subject to a whole spectrum of diagnoses, many of which we won't even understand.
One of the things I has been noted by a lot of people, myself included, is that the idea of preparing food at home has declined along with other aspects of the diet. And now there's much more packaged food, sort of semi-prepared or totally prepared food bought in a supermarket, or people go out to a restaurant to eat. And that means that you don't really have control over the ingredients. And I mean, one of the things I've noticed at restaurants is that there's a lot of sugar put into stuff, like into sauces or whatever, which makes everything, you know, if you put a little bit more salt and sugar into, say, a sauce, it tastes better. And therefore, if you're not controlling your own food, you're not controlling, you can't control your diet. Unless you go to a very high-end restaurant or a very high-end store where things are prepared to higher standards.
Mm-hmm. Excellent points that you make. And little by little, our modern-day society is usurping key components of our very humanity. And I do think that we need to do a better job of being defensive of the essential human qualities, the essential things that make us a higher species, such as protecting the environment, such as protecting our children from being harmed, protecting ourselves and our families from being exploited by others for profit, etc. When I walk into the average full-service supermarket, David, I know that 95% of what they're selling in that store is not fit for my consumption. Mm-hmm. Even in the area where I immediately go to, in the fruits and vegetables section, I know that in most cases, those fruits and vegetables are grown according to corporate standards, which use high levels of genetically modified seed stock, as well as high levels of chemical pesticides and weed controllers, etc. So it takes a holistic mindset, for one, of being cautious, being skeptical in the first place, but also, rather than just be mean about life, life is mean and threatening to me, we need to have real viable solutions into place. One of the things I'm working on, and I'd love to talk to you more about this in the future, are the rise of intentional communities. Mm-hmm. And I am specifically working on acquiring several hundred acres of land in the United States as well as outside of the United States for the completion of what we call our Kuji, short for Kuji Chagalia, self-determination, village wellness resorts, where we can create a holistic environment where people can come for a weekend or come for a month, and they can live in an intentional community where they know the food is all healing food, where they're going to get access to clean, pure water to drink, and the right type of exercise and meditation and companionship, the relationships that help us to build holistic lifestyles and to build complete health of our mind, body, and spirit. I'm extremely optimistic, David, because I think we've never been in a better position to be able to create these type of intentional communities. While at the same time, if we look around at what's happening to most people, it's not a pretty situation, especially when we look at the way the corporations are cashing in on our vulnerabilities.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think of people working minimum wage, 50, 60 hours a week. They don't have the time or the money to have an optimum diet. And I think our industrial capitalist culture, whatever you want to call it, is causing a lot of that stress and is also pushing people towards, I don't have time, I don't have a lot of money, this packaged food is cheap, I'll buy it and bring it home. You know, whether it's those ramen dried noodles with that little package of God knows what chemicals in it, as opposed to fresher foods, which is becoming increasingly, I think, a luxury for people. Anyway, we've been talking a surprising amount of time, so I'd like to give you an opportunity to wrap things up, if you have any points you really need to get out in the last couple of minutes.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. And when we talk about the convenience of the chew-aside lifestyle, we are not using the whole brain. The prefrontal cortex, the most recent part of the brain to evolve, allows us the ability to look over the horizon, to calculate what are the long-term consequences of my short-term actions. And when we equate into the cost of food, the cost of sickness, and the cost of health care, out-of-pocket expenses and national expenses, it is cheaper to eat healthy than it is to eat unhealthy. And there's no denying that equation. I have committed my life to this, and I'm into this so deep that victory is the only thing that we can accept from this point forward. So we're going to do great things. I've now written and published some 34 books, six of which are in this series we call Living Superfood, which you can go to livingsuperfood.com, no S, livingsuperfood.com, and learn more about the books.
I'll put that in the show notes.
Thank you, David. I appreciate you, man. And lastly, I'll quote with this. No one has ever denied this statement to be untrue. This is the absolute truth. Food is nature's most perfect medicine. And I say further, when it comes to living superfood and my own recipe books, medicine ain't never tasted like this before, David.
Okay. I got one last question for you. If you were to suggest another guest, challenging ideas, somebody who doesn't get a lot of airtime on the mainstream media, who would it be? Preferably somebody living.
Yeah, one of the people who has become really kind of an absolute icon in my life, upon whose shoulders I stand, is the, we call him the godfather of the modern raw vegan food movement, Dr. Aris Latham. I know he lives in Montego Bay, Jamaica, but he travels around the world quite a bit. He's the founder of Sun-Fired Foods. And when we talk about absolute deliciousness in food that gives us a body that just keeps going and going and going better than Energizer Bunny, Dr. Aris Latham, L-A-T-H-A-M, is a perfect example. And when you see his body, some people say the same thing about me, you would be hard-pressed to believe that they're actually, the body has been around the sun as many times as has actually happened. He's an absolute epitome of the youthfulness through high nutrition.
Keidi, thank you so much for joining me today.
David, I appreciate this opportunity. I'm going to continue listening to your work. It is superb, my friend.
Thank you, and goodbye. Thank you for listening to episode 223 of The Infectious Myth. If you have a comment, question, or suggestion for a future guest, please email me at david.crow@theinfectiousmyth.com. Like us at facebook.com/theinfectiousmyth. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at infectiousmyth. Commit to monthly donations of any amount on Patreon or LinkedIn.